This video is part of a series that I'm doing on framebuffer objects in WebGL 2. In the last two videos, we looked at the basics of how framebuffer objects work and wrote some code showing how they're typically used, and then explored some of the details that make framebuffer objects seem so complicated. For the next few videos, we're going to be looking at some of the techniques that use framebuffer objects, and we're starting off here with deferred rendering. You may also have heard the terms deferred lighting, deferred shading, and G-buffers. There may be subtle differences, but these terms all basically point to the same idea. And while this almost always comes up in relation to lighting, it really has nothing to do with lighting itself. It's more of a general technique that I hope you'll remember you can use in all sorts of other unrelated situations. That's because what deferred rendering is really all about is avoiding the performance penalty you get when you combine overdraw with extremely expensive shader calculations. It does that by deferring, or delaying, those expensive calculations until after overdraw is finished. Here's an overview of how it works. Of course, because this is a framebuffer technique, let's start off with a simple setup. Now, this is how I visualized it last time, but this time, let's keep it super simple, like this. We'll begin in our geometry program over here. Let's assume that it has lots of overlapping geometry, and its fragment shader contains a very nasty calculation. We're actually not going to do anything here about that overdraw. I mean, we could try to optimize our mesh to minimize that, but let's imagine that in this case, overdraw is simply going to happen. Instead, all we're going to do is move that expensive fragment shader code away from the geometry program and into the quad program. And that's it. That's the secret sauce. Clearly, we can't just move the calculation and nothing else. Those calculations depend on inputs, so we need to make sure that those are available somehow in the quad program instead. Typically, our inputs will come in only two types. We'll probably have some of them in uniforms, and those are incredibly simple to move. But then there's also the per fragment data sent in from the vertex shader. For example, position and normal vectors, UV coordinates, and maybe even instance data like base color or texture array index. These probably come into the fragment shader via varyings. We can't just move those declarations. Instead, we need to use a two-step process. Output those varying values to the framebuffer object and store them in separate textures, and then read them back using samplers when rendering the quad. So, move the code, move its uniforms, save its per fragment data to textures, and read those values back using samplers. Now, easier said than done, but essentially, that's all there is to it. Downsides? Yes. Yes, there are. Take a look at this example. Before deferred rendering, we drew all of the colored pixels that you see now, plus a bunch of blue pixels that ended up getting covered up. With deferred rendering, we skipped those non-visible blue fragments, which is great, but you know what else we added back in? Literally everything else. Remember that we're rendering a texture to a quad here, so every pixel of this canvas was rendered using that same fragment shader. We'll probably use an if statement to skip the calculations for these unpopulated fragments, but do not forget, your fragment shader will execute for every fragment of your quad. Also, there's those added textures. Now, memory is not so much of an issue usually, but remember that each device has a limited number of texture slots, as few as just 16. So every texture that we use for geometry data now can't be used for image textures. Plus there's the framebuffer object, the second program, the second draw call, not to mention your code just got a lot longer. So you really need to think about whether deferred rendering will help more than it hurts. But if you have a lot of overdraw and an expensive fragment shader, this actually is a well-established solution that's pretty simple to implement. So try it out and see if it makes a big difference. So with that, let's give this a try. Here's our running application. It's got one directional light and four moving point lights. I actually don't really care about the lighting code here. It's not even particularly expensive. I just wanted something non-trivial this time. So we're going to be moving this, The code relies on lighting values that we pass in as uniforms here. And our per fragment data includes varyings from the vertex shader, a normal and a position, which we have to move to. I've already added a full screen quad, which you can see here. Just for now, let's draw only half of it so that we can see both programs at the same time. And turn off animation so that my computer doesn't melt during screen capture. Let's create a frame buffer object, just like we did in the first video. I'm sending in the quad program as an argument, so we can use that later when we set our uniforms. The function doesn't exist, so let's create it. Create the frame buffer object and return it. Bind it. Attach a texture to color attachment 0. And that's where we'll put our position texture. And another to color attachment 1 for the normal texture. Remember these color attachment numbers. We'll need them later. Our geometry program has depth testing enabled, so we'll need to add a depth render buffer as well. Our textures don't exist yet, so we'll create them now. Note that I'm using RGBA 8 here, which I explained in the last video is a normalized integer. If you're not sure what to use here, this is always a good place to start. And the depth render buffer with 16 bits of precision. And save. Now, let's bind our frame buffer before our geometry draw call. This works, but remember, it's not deferred rendering yet. We've not moved any code. Just temporarily, let's resume animation. And that didn't work, and that's because we need to clear the color and depth buffers before each draw call. Do that, and we're good. Now it's time to move our shader code. Move the calculation and final color output. Move the uniforms. We're not outputting color data anymore. Instead, we want to output the normal and position data and assign them. Don't forget to apply output locations or the program will throw. So remember, we decided to put position texture at color attachment 0 and normal texture at color attachment 1. So that means position goes at location equals 0 and normal goes at location equals 1. And with that, our geometry program is finished. Time to fix our calculation code because it is packed with broken references. We now have two samplers. Let's call them position sampler and normal sampler. So all of our inputs are there now. Let's fix the code that makes the calculation. VNormal used to be a varying. Now we need to extract its value using a texture call. It's a VEC3, so we should take only the first three components. The sampler is normal sampler, and it's at the VTexChord varying location. And do the same thing for the position value. Check for typos. And last, we replace VLocalPosition, which was the varying, with the position value that we just retrieved from the texture. And now our second shader is done as well. At this point, there's basically just three things left to do, and we're going to do them all at once. But let's break them down for clarity. Our lights are sent via uniforms, but right now those are still going to the geometry program. We got to send them to the quad program instead, so we just need to change a single reference to do that. Our geometry program has two outputs, but right now, remember, by default, frame buffer objects will only capture one of them because we've not called draw buffers yet. That's a single line of code. And now we've got two textures, and multiple textures are a bit tricky if you're not used to using them. So I'm a little bit worried that some viewers may get a bit overwhelmed by all the tiny changes that I'm about to make here, so let's do a super fast review of how rendering multiple textures works. Let's say in our JavaScript we create a texture object, and in our shader we declare a sampler. If that's all we have, then we're good, because WebGL is configured by default for this exact situation. Single texture, single sampler. But add a second texture and a second sampler into the same draw call, now WebGL's defaults will fail us. That second texture is going to sit on top of the first. It won't overwrite it, but the shader will never see that first texture. And even though we declared two separate samplers, they're both pointing to the same texture object in memory. In this case, that's the second texture object. That's why we need texture units. Texture units manage these relationships, and it's done using active texture and setUniform1i. We call active texture and then bind texture like this to assign position texture to texture 0. Later we call active texture and then bind texture like this, and now normal texture will be assigned to texture 1. So half of the connections are taken care of now. Next, we need to tell our shaders which of these texture units goes with which sampler. Of course, because these samplers are declared as uniforms, we need to use one of the setUniform functions. We're assigning a texture unit by its location number. That's a single integer. So of course we use setUniform1i here. Call setUniform1i with position sampler's location and 0, and now position texture is connected all the way through to position sampler. Then call setUniform1i with normal sampler's location and 1, and normal texture will be connected all the way through to normal sampler. Maybe you already knew all of this, but I just hope that it makes the rest of this a little bit easier to take in. So the first thing that we need to do is assign each texture object to its own texture unit. Just like we discussed, let's assign normal texture to texture 1 and position texture to texture 0. Next, our geometry shader has two outputs, but remember that our framebuffer object is configured with its defaults, so only a single output will be recorded, the one at location equals 0. So we need to call drawBuffers to get it to capture both outputs. And we need to tell the quad shader which texture unit goes with which sampler. We do that with setUniform1i. And the very last thing that we need to do is update the lights uniform. They're still being sent to the geometry program right now. All of this is managed by a single function, so we just need to change the program's reference, and everything should work. I said everything should work. And everything's working. Wait. Yeah, not really. So this is because I chose to use RGBA8 as the storage type for both the position and normal texture data. If you watched my last video on the gnarly details of framebuffer objects, you'll know that RGBA8 can only represent values between 0 and 1. For sure, that's no good for normals, since their components can be anywhere between negative 1 and positive 1. And as for our position coordinates, they can be negative or positive, but they can also get quite large. So the easiest fix for this is to enable true floating point storage types and change our textures from RGBA 8 to RGBA 16F, which is a true floating point storage type. And that fixes it. Now, this is probably where I would leave it myself, but if you wanted to avoid loading that extension or just needed a bit more performance, you can use some simple math to squeeze your position and normal values into that RGBA 8. It would probably look like this. In this case, it's for a brightness calculation, so even a large loss of precision and range might not even be noticeable, but that's your call. And that's it. If there are any takeaways from this, it's that deferred rendering is not necessarily a lighting technique, it's a performance optimization. It's there to reduce the number of times your fragment shader calculations are run. and that the optimization is quite expensive all by itself. So, by all means, try it out, but profile your application and see if it's worth it. The next video that I'm going to be doing will probably be on object picking. See you then.